Obama wants to redistribute the wealth. Well, I disagree. I think you need to earn what you get in life. So join me, because I'm going to be redistributing the truth, one word at a time, here on the Unsolicited Opinion.
I thought you walked tall! Looks like you gotta learn how to crawl!
Walking Tall. The story of a real man who has become a living legend.
Why don't you try this job on for size?
I was elected sheriff on one issue, that I'd bust every joint in the whole county.
Talk to Whitted this morning. He said to put him away.
They beat him.
How does it feel to be part of the oppressed minority?
They cut him.
He has come home to get out killed.
They taunted him.
You can't let him! Join him!
They tempted him. They even shot him.
Ordinary man wouldn't have made it through.
But they couldn't shut him up.
You let them do this to me and get away with it, and you give them the eternal right to do the same damn thing to any one of you!
Or hold him down. He was going to give them law and order, or die trying. Walking Tall.
Hey, everybody, this is Maggie Rodden, and this is the Unsolicited Opinion. How you doing today? Now, I know all of you know that movie, and that's actually from the original movie that they did back in, I don't know, about 76 or something like that. I know they did a remake with The Rock, but I wanted to play the original music or soundtrack from that original movie. And because my guest who's going to be joining me after the first break today is another gentleman who is someone who stands on principle. He is a sheriff who walks tall, and I just wish that we had more sheriffs like this gentleman in our country to stand up and be counted and to walk tall and stand on principle and to do the right thing. Because as I say over and over and over again on this show, the problem with America is we are collapsing under the corruption, the weight of the corruption. And that's what's dragging down this country, and that's what's destroying it, because everybody's palm has been greased and they've had their hand out and everybody's looking for something for nothing, and nobody is walking tall and standing on principle anymore. I should say few people are. There are a handful who do, but for the most part, people don't, and that's the problem. If you don't stand up for what's right, then you are in essence giving your vote to what's wrong, aren't you? So it's real important that you got to walk tall. I know I was ranting and raving about this yesterday. You've got to stand up and be counted. You can't sit on the sidelines. And if you don't do it now, listen, it's now or never. Now is the time. It's not somewhere down the road. It's not when you retire. It's not when you think, well, I got to have my three hots and a cock guaranteed. It's none of those times. The time is now. And the time to be able to stand up and fight back and be counted is now, because you're getting not stronger every day. You're getting weaker every day, because the more strength you allow them to gain is the less strength you have. So unless you stand on principle, you stand for nothing. It's one or the other, right or wrong. There's no in between. There's no gray area when it comes to right or wrong, is there? I can't think of one. Now, I want to read a little something, and I don't know if I'll get through all of it before I bring my guest on after the break, but I want to tell you how I heard of this gentleman, and his name is Sheriff Tony DeMeo, and he is the sheriff of Nye County out in Nevada. And I am aware, because all of you know, I'm always talking about UN Agenda 21, sustainable development, property rights, assault on property rights, the guests that I bring on this show. 99 9/10% of them, of course, all have something to do with one way or another fighting this assault against property rights here in this nation. Listen, that's the break. So we're going to break. We'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. This is the Unsolicited Opinion. Don't go away. I will be back with my guest, so hang in there.
Introducing IXL Anti-Friction Metal Conditioner. IXL works at the molecular level to reduce friction by penetrating into and bonding onto the microscopic openings of the walls of ferrous-based metals. The surfaces become smoother and denser, and this reduces the heat, friction, and metal expansion and wear caused by moving metal surfaces. The benefits are reduced maintenance activities and cost, increased fuel efficiency, and prolonged equipment life. It will not clog pipes, injectors, or supply lines, does not build up or accumulate on itself as do many other additives. IXL does not contain moly, PTFE, or graphite. It also offers the tremendous benefit of being non-toxic. It is used for a friction reducer and performance enhancer in gas or diesel engines, transmissions, automatic or standard gearboxes, turbos, electric motors, outdrives, lathe, and cutting applications. Go to republicbroadcasting.org, then to our online store, or call us at 800-724-2719. That's 800-724-2719.
Are you still paying your credit cards and so-called bank loans thinking that you owe the money? Do you feel like it's your moral obligation but can't see an end in sight? Well, what if I told you that in truth, you don't owe a single penny and that the banks know this and hope you don't find out? Here's where we come in. Free2Prosper.com specializes in a profound debt repudiation method which challenges the validity of your so-called debts, morally frees you from the burdens, and protects your property. Our system is often superior to settlement, bankruptcy, or consolidation, which often leave you in a worse situation. If you feel the moral obligation to take care of yourself and your family, then I urge you to consider taking action right now. The economy will not wait. If you want to know more so you can prosper through the economic collapse, all while staying honorable and true to yourself, then call 877-417-8393. That's 877-417-8393. Or visit free2prosper.com right now.
Do you flinch when a police car appears in your rearview mirror or you get pulled over? Are you squeamish when an envelope arrives in the mail with a return address of a court, a government agency like the IRS, or some law firm? Would you like to escape government agency harassment? Then visit escapeharassment.com. George Bush allegedly says, the government constitution is nothing but a doggone piece of paper. Well, that's a contract. A contract is an offer acceptance of that offer, at which point a contract arises by law and the offeror can no longer withdraw the offer. We teach, do not accept. That way there is no contract or agreement for you to go to their court or private club meeting. To escape government agency harassment like the IRS, visit escapeharassment.com. This is a tried and proven experienced process, not experimental, with a money-back guarantee that it works and success testimonials from previous students. Remember, escapeharassment.com. That's escapeharassment.com.
This is Maggie Rodden. This is the Unsolicited Opinion. I want to give you the call-in number today, 800-313-9443, 800-313-9443. I want to say hello to everybody who's listening all around the country and on our latest station, which is in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, KHFX, 1140 AM Dallas. Hello to everybody in Texas, to all the other states, all around the world. People tune in to Republic Broadcasting Network from all around the world. So that's a good thing because people know that we redistribute the truth here on this network. And so I suggest if you have a business or a service and you'd like to have your message get out there to people who understand how critical the truth is, then I suggest you get in touch with Republic Broadcasting Network. You can do that through calling us, 800-724-2719. You can go to our website and get in touch with us that way, republicbroadcasting.org. You can send us a letter via snail mail, 2251 Double Creek Road, number 302, Round Rock, Texas, 78664 is our address. You can also find us on Facebook, Republic Broadcasting Network. You can follow our tweets on Twitter at RBN Live. So listen, lots of ways to get in touch with us. You can just don't make a donation to the cause because free speech is not free. You already know that. There's no free lunch in life. I probably say that once a show. I imagine I probably do. Anyway, listen, call in number 800-313-9443. My website is three words, theunsolicitedopinion.com. TheUnsolicitedOpinion.com. If you'd like to get in touch with me, there is a contact button on my website. I suggest that you take a look at it. There's a lot of information up there, and so please do that. Now I want to welcome my guest. My guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo. Is it DeMeo or DeMeo? Am I pronouncing it right?
Good morning, Megan. Thanks for having me on your show. It's DeMeo.
DeMeo?
That's close enough.
Okay, yes, like tomato, tomato, right?
Yeah,
anyway,
I'm so
glad you could come on with me, Sheriff. I really appreciate it. I am so thankful that there are people like you who stand up and do the right thing, Sheriff DeMeo, because we don't have enough people like you. And that's what all Americans recognize. We don't have enough people who are standing up and doing the right thing. They don't honor the oath that they had taken at all.
Well, that's a problem, but let me just say, you know, there's quite a few sheriffs and those in law enforcement that are doing the right thing and standing up for the people, making sure that the government is held at bay. But yeah, you know, I don't know if you know that but there's a movement in some certain states to actually eliminate the office of sheriff or make it an appointment rather than elected office, and you know, so but those are some of the concerns that that sheriffs are facing in one state in particular. I know, if you don't know this, in Connecticut, there are no sheriffs. They limited that office a while ago. And in other states, they limit the ability, through legislation, they limit the ability of the sheriffs. You know, they kind of restrict them in a lot of respects. Unfortunately, in the West, you know, the sheriffs are an office holder, and our chain of command is the citizens who we serve, and not necessarily some bureaucrat that's appointed by another elected board. So we're fortunate. But if you look through on the country, you know, I come from, you know, I was born and raised in New York City, in Brooklyn. There, the sheriff is appointed by the mayor, and the only thing they can do is basically do civil seizures. You know, so then they don't have, you know, and people look at that and they kind of wonder, you know, you talk about sheriff in New York, in New York City, they're the five boroughs, and all their appointment by the mayor there, and they basically are very limited. They don't have the broad powers that sheriffs in the West, other sheriffs throughout the states have, based upon the freedom that they're given through the legislation, through law, to actually maintain an office and protect those who we serve.
Yeah. How many states, Sheriff DeMeo? How many states have eliminated sheriffs? Has Connecticut? Is that the only one thus far?
That's the only one thus far, but I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe Oregon or Washington. I think Oregon is one of the states that is looking at making that an appointment. I know that there's a letter floating around recently that there's some concerns with the National Sheriff's Association is concerned that can happen. I know the Western Sheriffs, I belong to the Western Sheriffs Association here as well, and you know, there's always some concern that some government, some legislatures will do that. Will try to eliminate the office of sheriff as being elected office, but being one of the appointments. See, then that's the problem. You have an appointment. It's like being a police chief. The agency I worked for before was a police department, and the police chief is appointed by the mayor. Then they have to follow what the mayor says, or the other elected offices, like a chamber. You know, the council has to say, and they control the ability of the police chief to go one way or the other. And if the police chief doesn't fall in line with those people, then they're fired. So there's a lot of restrictions with police departments. With sheriffs, the chain of command we have is directly to the people who put us in office. You know, I'm not part of the sheriff's office. I mean, I'm not a deputy. I'm a sheriff here, and you know, I'm not a member of the sheriff's office. I'm the sheriff's office. I mean, it's kind of confusing because people say, well, what about your contract? I don't get days off. You know, we basically are put in place by the people to serve the people. We represent the people of, like here, I represent people in Nye County in the sheriff's office, making sure that we do the best job we can on behalf of the citizens of Nye County, and making sure that we follow we have to follow the Constitution, we follow the state laws and the state Constitution, and, you know, so we have to make sure we keep in line with that and that we don't have undue outside influences in hindering us from doing our job. And that can happen if there's appointments.
Yeah, exactly. that's the one thing. I've had Sheriff Mack on my show a couple of times, and that's the one thing that I think a lot of people don't understand, and I really never did either. I had gotten involved. I'm in Pennsylvania. The network is in Texas. I had gotten involved in this sheriff's project here to try to you know, like have a sheriff. We called it the Sheriff's Brigade, but we couldn't get much interest here. We're in the county I am, though there are a few counties in Pennsylvania who are trying to work actively with the sheriff to make sure the sheriff actually understands their unique role as the only elected law enforcement officer. It didn't work out so well where I am. I'm outside of Philadelphia, so, you know, they're not, you know, it's kind of falls on deaf ears around here, but
I understand that. You know, if you look at the, you know, it's unique about the East Coast. I mean, you know, as you can tell, I'm not from Nye County originally.
No, I wouldn't have guessed.
as it says at the movie Silverado with Johnny Gleeson, he says, you know, as you can tell, I'm not from these parts, but the assistants are totally, you know, taking me in their embrace. And I have to understand, the citizens of Nye County have taken me in their embrace. You know, I talk with a foreign accent. And those are some of the issues with Wayne Hage, because I tried to call Wayne Hage a couple times when I was running for sheriff. He refused to take my phone calls because I talk with a foreign accent from the East Coast. And people believe that you don't necessarily understand the issues, you know, that face the people in your area. And being, you know, I was, you know, Jersey City Police. I was involved in community policing. I was part of the chiefs of police, the police chief effort to decrease crime. And the way we did that is through community policing. And, you know, we understand that you have to immerse yourself with your city if you're going to understand all the nuances and all the problems that area is faced with. And I did a lot of studying. I read Wayne Hage's book, Stonewall's Rainlands. I understood it, which he kind of was surprised. And when I finally, the third time, he's yelling and screaming at you, I'm never going to talk to you again. I said, wait a minute, let me see if I got your problem. And I read your book, and with that, we were on the phone about 2 hours, and he wanted to meet me. And, of course, we struck up a friendship with Mr. Hage, because I understood the issues of what was happening in Nye County and those issues of the West. But in other areas, you know, like in the East Coast, they fall into sheriff's office sometimes. Not all of them just fall into the same, you know, concept of police departments, and where, you know, they're maneuvered and, you know, swayed according to some kind of a, you know, political move or doing what I call sometimes they become, you know, they run for office for one reason and they get political amnesia once they're in office. There's a great deal of that political amnesia in Washington, D.C., unfortunately.
Yeah.
So we have to, you know, you have to maintain your principles. And, you know, I've even people can know me back in Jersey City and, you know, I could tell you, I don't keep my mouth shut. If I believe in a cause, I go forward with that, you know, and the best I can. And, you know, that's one thing I think was kind of helping me in Nevada, and especially in Nye County, was the fact that something had to be done, something wasn't right. And it doesn't make any difference how big the beast is, and in this case, the federal government with BLM and U.S. Forestry Service. But the fact of the matter is, you stood with on the grounds of having a document, which is law across the land, which I'd point out to BLM and the U.S. Forestry Service, that the U.S. Constitution is the same in the East Coast, and the same as the West Coast, the same as from, you know, north to south. It's the law of the land, and that everyone is obligated to follow that. And if you don't follow the Constitution, you don't follow the laws that are in place, then you're going to have injuries, and you're going to have someone step in your way. And, you know, it was me. Because under the other sheriff, there was cattle seizures, and much to the dismay of Mr. Hage, because, you know, Wayne told me, he said, I even gave the former sheriff my first, his first donation was for me, you know, in 1990. So, I mean, it's, you have to really, be on top of the game here, and you have to basically confront them. And, you know, with the problems of Mr. Hage, I mean, I really, if anybody really looked at, this guy went through heartache. I mean, he lost his wife. I mean, he believes that his wife died based upon all the aggravation that the U.S. government gave them. That, you know, they landed on Mr. Hage. They try and make an example out of him. You know, when they did the cattle seizure in the early 90s, it was one where, you know, they actually had, you know, armed individuals with sniper rifles on the hills surrounding his land. The ranch where he was going at, and he was afraid that for his life.
Hang on, Sheriff, because we've got to go to break. We'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. My guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo from Nye County, Nevada. We'll be right back.
purification systems have long been recognized as the world's ultimate in water purification. Berkey's are used worldwide under normal, hostile, and emergency environments. Securing your access to good-tasting, sparkling, wholesome drinking water can be harder than you might expect. Water is often laced with chlorine, lead, high levels of harmful bacteria, and other unwanted chemicals and contaminants. Even bottled water can contain these contaminants, and moreover, it's expensive. Other purification systems are inferior. Most do remove pathogenic bacteria, and many remove the beneficial minerals that your body needs. Perhaps that's why Berkey systems have long been recognized as the world's ultimate in water purification. This simple, highly effective method of microporous, self-sterilizing, and recleanable black Berkey purification elements bring you the finest water purification system available anywhere. Call today, 1-800-724-2719. That's 1-800-724-2719. Or go to our online store, republicbroadcasting.org. Free shipping for a limited time only.
Are skyrocketing prescription costs draining your budget? If you don't have insurance or are taking medication not covered by insurance, the Powerhouse Savings Card can lower your prescription costs by up to 50%. Now you and your family can save 20 to 50% on all prescriptions. It's accepted by most pharmacies and mail-order pharmacies nationwide. No prescription card is easier to use. Just show your card and save 20 to 50% right on the spot. There are no monthly fees. Just a one-time processing fee of only $4.95 for you and your immediate family. Stop paying full price for prescriptions. Stop going without the medication you need because it costs too much. Now your family can get the prescriptions they need at a cost you can afford. Call 1-800-963-0232 now and start saving money with the Powerhouse Savings Card. Call 1-800-963-0232. 1-800-963-0232. 1-800-963-0232.
Keeping food on hand for emergencies protects you the same way as does insurance on your home or car. With Freeze Dry Guy freeze-dried foods in your food reserve, you can be ready for just about any unexpected crisis. Right now, for the month of October 2011, Freeze Dry Guy is letting their customers get first dibs on the meat bucket special. That's roasted chicken, Southwest-style chicken, teriyaki-style chicken, stroganoff-style beef, cheesy ground beef, and savory roasted ground beef. Just add hot water and enjoy. Portable, easy, convenient. Real meat, real good. Supplies won't last with this special offer. Order today to beef up your freeze-dried meat supply. You'll even get $20 back in survival bucks or loyalty dollars when you beat the rush and order our freeze-dried meat buckets. Go to freezedryguy.com. That's freezedryguy.com. Or call 866-404-3663. That's 866-404-FOOD.
Everybody, this is Maggie Rodden. This is the Unsolicited Opinion. The call-in number is 800-313-9443, 800-313-9443. My website, three words, theunsolicitedopinion.com. If you'd like to go there, there's a contact button on my website. So if you want to shoot me a missive, you're free to do so. My guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo, and I had the word up on break. I'm embarrassed, but I'm telling you, Sheriff DeMeo, my mind is like a sieve sometimes.
It doesn't make any difference.
Well, some people are very temperamental about, you know, my name is Alice.
It's five letters. And I'm so used to all my life being mispronounced. I go, okay, spell my name right. You know, unfortunately, the federal government knows how to spell my name right.
Well, I want to, because I know a lot of people listening may not be aware of who we're talking about in the story about Wayne Hage. So I'm going to read a little bit of something about his background so people understand, and then you can jump in and talk about how you got involved with this. And Sheriff DeMeo, I have a lot of people on my show who are being assaulted all the time. Their property rights are being denied to them through zoning and code enforcement. It's incredible what's happening all over the country. It's absolutely a mind blower. And so I thought it was so critical that people hear what had happened to Mr. Hage. So I'm going to read this, and we've got a few minutes before we hit the next break, and then we have a caller, Sheriff. So the war against Wayne Hage, there is no such thing as civil liberties if you do not have property rights, and that's a quote from Wayne Hage. It was once believed that a man's home was his castle, yet as our government continues to exercise its right to obtain private property for public use in sometimes questionable circumstances, the domains of hardworking Americans are increasingly coming under siege. Wayne Hage is a self-made man. He started supporting himself at age 15 and paid his way through undergraduate and graduate school, earning a master's degree in organic chemistry. After working several ranches, cattle ranches in Nevada as a young teen, he knew that he wanted a place of his own. In 78, he realized his dream when he purchased Pine Creek Ranch in Nye County, Nevada, which adjoins the federally administered Tioga and Humboldt National Forests and Monitor Valley. A couple of months after Hage purchased the 752,000-acre ranch, which he and his wife, Jean, manage, along with five children, two agents from the National Park Service appeared and informed Hage that they were going to buy his ranch. However, they only offered him about half of what he had just paid. When Mr. Hage made it clear that he was not willing to sell, the harassment began. It started with the U.S. Forest Service and Bureau of Land Management filing a claim on the water rights to Hage Ranch. Ranch after Forest Service rangers fenced in a critical spring to pipe water into the ranger's cabin. Since Pine Creek Ranch is comprised of mostly desert terrain, access to water for cattle and wildlife is crucial. Hage's only recourse was to petition the Nevada State Engineer for a determination of who owned what. This was in October of 1981. Adjudication stretched out for 10 years because of numerous delay tactics used by the Forest Service. The ranger's fence still stands today, and this is an article I'm reading from 2004, and a lot has changed from 2004. In the meantime, harassment, taking of cattle, and government interference in the daily operations of Hage's property were driving the ranch to the brink of collapse, not to mention the personal drain of time, money, and lost income incurred during the three administrative appeals Hage filed and won. His wife and children were run off the road. His pickup was shot at while Hage was nearby. The Forest Service and Bureau of Land Management, along with various environmentalist groups, were formulating constant changes in regulations, making it increasingly expensive to operate Pine Creek Ranch, the primary reason the well-respected previous owners sold it. Indeed, over a period of 105 days, Hage received 40 certified letters and more than 70 personal visits, each citing him in violation of a creatively new bureaucratic regulation. In one instance, Hage sent a horse and rider to ride a 20-mile fence line to verify a violation, only to find there was one staple missing in the entire fence line, dutifully earmarked with a bright blue flag. Then there were 45 counts of trespass, charging that Hage's cattle were grazing in the wrong locations. Yet on more than one occasion, more than one eyewitness watched the Forest Service move the cattle into a trespass area and then cite Hage for the violation. Things became even more serious in 91 when the Forest Service, armed with semi-automatic weapons and wearing bulletproof vests, confiscated some of Hage's cattle. Hage had previously worked for the Forest Service and BLM and knew that their part of their unwritten procedure in dealing with people is to provoke confrontation. In preparing to confiscate Hage's cattle, the Forest Service repeatedly sent out emails and made phone calls, portraying Hage as one who can only be dealt with in very extreme measures. An aggravated confrontation becomes an easy and lawful way for a federal agency to come after an individual if that citizen reacts and physically threatens the federal agents involved. This was the scenario with the infamous 1992 Ruby Ridge incident, where federal agents shot and killed Randy Weaver's wife and son after Weaver engaged federal agents. In the end, Weaver was found innocent of any charges after standing trial and was eventually awarded $3.1 million settlement against the federal government. Amazingly, Hage kept his composure during this ordeal. When he drove to the site where his cattle had been confiscated, he found 34 service riders armed with semi-automatic weapons and bulletproof vests, some stationed on high points, clearly expecting confrontation. Mr. Hage just took out his 35-millimeter camera and took their picture. We are going to break. I'm going to let Sheriff DeMeo finish this story. When we come back, we'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. This is the Unsolicited Opinion. My name is Maggie Rodden. Don't go away.
You're listening to the Republic Broadcasting Network. Because you can handle the truth.
Aerial spraying, chemtrails, the modified atmosphere, heavy metals and pesticides, carcinogens and chemical fibers all falling from the sky. You have a choice to keep your body clean. Detoxify with microplant powder from hempusa.org or call 908-691-2608. It's odorless and tasteless and used in any liquid or food. Protect your family now with microplant powder. Cleaning out heavy metals, parasites, and toxins. Order it now for daily intake and stock it now for long-term storage. Visit hempusa.org or call 908-691-2608 today.
Extend your life with Extendovite.
When I had a heart attack at 42, I was not sure what the future held. But a year later, the doctors could find nothing wrong with me and took me off all my medication. What did I do? I took a herbal mixture of garlic, cayenne, and a few other herbs mixed in liquid form. I now call this Extendovite. I would have never believed that a few simple herbs could actually change my life like they did. Now it's your turn to see what the powers of garlic and cayenne can do for you. For only $69.95 plus shipping and handling for a 2-month supply of either capsules or liquid, you too can begin on your path to better health. For more information, call 1-877-928-8822. That's 1-877-928-8822 or visit our website at heartdrop.com.
Extend your life with Extendovite.
Did you know that the water you're drinking may contain over 2,000 different contaminants? From hormone-disrupting and mind-altering chemicals like fluoride in pharmaceuticals to newly emerging contaminants like radiation and other hybrid chemicals that water treatment plants don't screen out of our drinking water. PureEffectFilters.com has a breakthrough filter solution to effectively reduce the widest range of such contaminants, including the radiation coming from the Fukushima disaster. In addition, the filters will also revitalize your water by releasing natural minerals and electrolytes while increasing pH and antioxidant levels. Safeguard and revitalize your drinking water today with a breakthrough Pure Effect water filter system. Visit PureEffectFilters.com to learn more or contact us today at 1-888-891-4821. That's 1-888-891-4821. Call now and take one of the most important steps you'll take to a healthier future.
Everybody, this is Maggie Rod, and this is the Unsolicited Opinion, and I am telling you, my office where I'm sitting broadcasting from, it is a booby trap. I'm not kidding. I have different office chairs in here because none of them, I can't sit on any of them, and this one I was just sitting in, I fell backwards in the damn thing. I'm just glad that the glass is pretty strong in the door behind me because my head hit the door. I'm telling you, I am jinxed sometimes. Anyway, I guess I'm going to live here. So my guest is Sheriff Tony DeMeo, Nye County, Nevada Sheriff. And I was telling the story, reading a story about, well, it's not a story, it's a truth. It's a true story about Wayne Hage and what he was up against and how the goal is to drive people off their land. And they are using, by hook or crook, our government and the agencies in our government, Bureau of Land Management, Forestry Service, you name it, they are all in cahoots with a lot of these environmental agencies, such as the Sierra Club, National Wildlife Federation, Nature Conservancy, on and on and on. You name them, they're all in the game. And the goal is, who is this? The attorney for the National Wildlife Federation said that their strategy was how to win is one at a time, one at a time. He goes out of business, he dies, you wait him out, and you win. Because their goal is to drive us off our land and to lock us in what I call green ghettos in these cities where we're all going to live in slimy ghettos and life will be a living hell. So you can either stand up and be counted like my guest Sheriff Tony DeMeo is today, or you can be herded like sheep into one of these green ghettos that they'll be erecting for all of us. And I got news for you. I ain't going without a fight. And I don't think Sheriff DeMeo is going to go without a fight either, because it's just not in his nature. And obviously, Mr. Hage, who is no longer with us, well, he didn't go down without a fight either. So let's go back to you, Sheriff.
I have to agree, because I actually grew up in one of those urban jungles, I mean, you know, and of course coming out here in the West, I mean, this is great. And just so you know, the organizations that you mentioned actually filed briefs, friends of the court briefs, against Wayne Hage during his lawsuit with the federal government. But and just so there was another cattle seizure in 2001, the year before I ran for sheriff, and I promised Wayne Hage that I would protect and support the Constitution, which is the oath of office we take. I think sometimes we forget that.
A lot of them forget it, Sheriff. That's right. For sure. That's our problem.
And that's the problem. And when I first became sheriff, of course, BLM and Forestry Service tried to push me around. And of course, they came to a state where they were on Wayne Hage's getting ready to do a cattle seizure. I sent my lieutenant up there, a couple of deputies. That's when I was informed by them that Al Brand, who was a solicitor for BLM, was threatening to have me arrested. I went, okay. And, you know, and I said, before I go to a lawyer, I just let him know I'm going to go through Bill O'Reilly, because that was a show that was on from Fox. And I said, I'll go on his show and lay out my case against the federal government. And to try to speed things up in August of 2004, I actually informed Wayne Hage. I had a meeting with at that time Bob Abbey, who was the state director of BLM, his law enforcement special agent in charge, Danette Gordon, in Vegas. Actually, the meeting took place in all things, because they kept saying it has nothing to do with water rights, but the meeting took place in Southern Nevada Water Building, of all places. I don't understand. Of all the federal buildings they have in Vegas, that's where they decided to hold this meeting. It was a one-hour meeting, which 55 minutes. So I laid out why they're not going to do what they want to do. I was informed by them that they're going to do it, and if they had to bring in law enforcement to do it, and we took that to mean their federal SWAT team, which is what they had against Wayne Hage basically in the 1990s. And I told them, I said, you bring your SWAT team, I have a SWAT team, we'll stand face to face, but you're not removing one piece of cattle or anything for Mr. Hage's land until you have a proper court order, which I was told they couldn't get one, which was amazing to me. You can't get an order from the court, which is so easy. I mean, we do that all the time in law enforcement. If you have a valid complaint and you have a valid reason to take property, you go to a seizure proceeding. Then they're pretty straight out. They couldn't do that. And, then we've had these little tussles back and forth. And after that meeting, the special agent in charge of Nevada got transferred to Vegas, and in July 2005, Bob Abbey resigned from the federal government. And and right after Wayne Hage died, I mean, he died in June of 2006, and BLM was getting kind of quiet, because I actually had a meeting with the new state SAC, which was Mark Bertle, and him and I get along famously, and we do have this open line of communication. We have the U.S. Forestry Service SAC, who comes to me and says, I'm in Maricopa County looking at Joe Arpaio's jails because we're looking to build a jail here, a new jail.
Oh, good for you. Good for you.
In Pahrump, Nevada. You know, we need a new jail. I was there, and I get a phone call from this U.S. Forestry Service Nevada SAC, Special Agent in Charge, and she tells me that we have a way of settling Wayne Hage's issues since he's dead. And I said, what's that? I'd like to meet with you. And I said, okay. So we had a meeting in my office here in Pahrump, Nevada, and I brought my captain in, and she tells us that they're getting ready to do a good thing about doing a cattle seizure against Wayne Hage. I went, oh, no, you're not doing that. And, you know, we laid out the reasons why they're not going to do that. And one question I asked her, and this was Debbie Matthews, I said, who do you work for? I mean, who gives you authority?
Yeah.
And they says, the Congress. I went, no, I mean, we don't get our authority from the Congress. We got authority from the Constitution. We got authority from the people who put us in office, who put them in office. That's who we represent. I mean,
they don't get it. They don't get it. They don't get it at all. Who the hell do these people think they are?
Right.
I mean, really, they just think they're above the law. They can act with impunity. They can just do whatever they want. They can ride roughshod through people's lives. And no, they can't do that. Because you know what? What's going to happen, Sheriff, and I predict this, what's going to happen is the people are going to decide collectively they've had enough, and they're going to start looking for all of these people who think that they can operate above the law and they can take people's property, and all these zoning officers and these corrupt politicians and that. They think that, there's more Americans out there who've been jammed by these people than there are them.
And I think that people have to hold their elected officials in check, and they don't. I mean, you know, we got a presidential election coming up, and without maybe one or two candidates are talking about, you know, property rights and citizen rights and the fact that who we work for, the citizens who we represent. We don't hear that too much. We hear about other ancillary things, and those are important because the fact of the matter is that, you know, that they can come in, you know, and there's ways if you don't know your rights and you don't have people advocating for those things, you know, you have law enforcement that can say, when it's appropriate for them to say no, it's no. And I told, I told Bob Abbey, as I told anybody else with BLM and Forestry Service, you come with a court order. My ranchers here are obligated to follow the law. And to get an idea how big Wayne Hage's ranch is, what we're talking about, we're only talking about a couple of hundred head of cattle in an area that's the size of the state of Rhode Island. When you look at the 779,000 square acres that he had, it equates to like 1,182 square miles. I mean, you know, that's how much land we're talking about, a couple of hundred head of cattle. And Wayne Hage had to pull back his cattle, ranching operation because of the harassment he was getting from the federal government. And this whole issue was over the water rights, which the BLM people denied that, but I said, this is what it's all about. In fact, unfortunately, a couple of years after Wayne Hage died in 2008, the federal government sided with Wayne Hage, so the federal government was completely wrong. They awarded him a well over $4 million. And then in 2009, the federal government, the court awarded Wayne Hage about another $150,000 plus in monetary compensation for the water rights that he was denied. So the federal government lost in that. And, you know, Wayne Hage put up that fight, and, when he was on his deathbed and I visited Wayne, he was concerned what's going to happen after his death. And I said, Wayne, I'm here to protect the rights of the citizens of Nye County. And I don't think the fight's going to be over with BLM, U.S. Forestry Service. I mean, we're prepared for whatever happens, but I said, as long as I'm sheriff of Nye County, we'll make sure that the rights of your family and the rights of the citizens of Nye County are going to be protected to the best of my ability. And I made that promise to him to give, so he can have peace. And sure enough, a couple of years after that, the courts found in favor of Wayne Hage. But your remarks before were right. They're going to try to bankrupt you, to try to drag it to the ground, to where people say, enough is enough. And, and unfortunately, there's a lot of people, that come to a certain point and go, you know what, I'm just tired of this. And Wayne Hage, had a fighting spirit that wasn't diminished and with this long, drawn-out battle, which started in the 1990s and finally came to some kind of 17 years after he died, it finally came to some, it came to a conclusion. And, you know, and that's what this, and Wayne Hage, if you talk to ranchers that, that are in the same predicament, Wayne Hage was the one which was the shining light, as far as on property rights, because they, he was the one that's being constantly harassed. I mean, you know, it's kind of interesting that the weight of the federal government, in my opinion, came atop of Wayne Hage, you know, with the actions they did, with the threats, and, you know, they came to me and says, you know, we're thinking about doing this. And a lot of these things, I think they were posturing. I don't think they're going to come down with some kind of a, a federal SWAT team, because basically the fact of the matter is they were in the wrong. They couldn't even get a court order to seize cattle, which is a simple civil. You talk to a lawyer, and you talk to a lawyer about civil process, because this is what it would be. It's a pretty simple, straightforward thing. They couldn't get a civil process going to get his cattle, to take his to take away his allotment, and all the things they were claiming that he was so erroneously. He was violating all these laws and everything like that. To get a simple seizure order was pretty simple, and they couldn't do it. So, it's just amazing that, that they tried to push this to the level that they did, and they tried to overwhelm this rancher. But that was a problem that was happening in Nevada. It wasn't just Wayne Hage. There was other confiscations that took place. Ben Coven was another one, 2000. And one, he had like 800 cattle. He dropped his cattle down to 50, and they still went down there and they confiscated his cattle. He had like 5,500 square acres, 550,000 acres. Not as big as Wayne Hayes, but a pretty sizable ranch as well. And they confiscated his cattle as long as when they confiscated Ben, Wayne Hayes's cattle. The sheriff at the time, the DE at the time, apparently had information, in our opinion, that they were going to seize the cattle. They both took a trip up to Washington to go fishing during this time. And
They should be ashamed of themselves. You know, all these people who've gotten their palms greased. Sheriff, they're going to, I mean, listen, karma is an amazing thing in life. You know what I mean? So what's going to happen is all these people who boot and say, oh, I'm just going to go on a little fishing trip while this stuff takes place, this illegal stuff takes place. Everything that goes around comes around in life, Sheriff.
Right, and one of the things is, I felt bad for Lieutenant Phillips, who was left in charge at that time, and he was given the orders from the sheriff not to interfere, and he didn't interfere. And when I talked to Lieutenant, because when I took over as sheriff, I talked to Lieutenant. He said that was one of the worst days of my life. I mean, this is what I wanted to do. I was under the orders from the sheriff not to get involved in it, and it was tough for him, but that's why, when I went to, after I took off the sheriff, I went to this management seminar. And that's where I met the fire chief in Phoenix, and he had these empowerment cards, which I said, that's a pretty good idea. And I gave them to everyone. I gave my supervisors and my area commanders the ability to be in charge of those areas and with my full authority to take appropriate action on behalf of the people, protecting the people, and that's, we don't have those issues. In 2003, when they were thinking about seizing the cattle, Lieutenant said, I'm not going to let it happen. I'll contact the sheriff if you're threatening to place him under arrest, which I told him, come on down. I said, and don't wait for him to come down from Tonopah or from Reno to go get me. Have somebody from Las Vegas to come up, because we're only 45 miles outside of Las Vegas. I didn't want to wait the 4 hours for him to come down and try to arrest me. But they didn't do that. And they didn't do that. I mean, it's their posturing, the threatening, and so on and so forth. I believe, as I still believe, we were in the right. The Constitution says we're in the right. Nevada state law says we're in the right. They kind of like they were trying to stare us down. They blinked, and the rest is history. BLM, we get along. Honestly, I get along very well with the BLM agents and the Rangers and the SAC. We have a very good relationship. We actually communicate very well together. The all this arrogance that was present before has subsided in a lot of respects. I think a lot of it is the fact that they were looking at what was happening in the courts. They realized that there had some legal issues, I think that basically would. Proper direction, they kind of realize, hey, this ain't going to happen here in Nevada.
Well, maybe in Nye County, where you are, Well, but I can tell you, Sheriff, these things, the land grabs are still taking place all over the country.
Well, because we don't think, because the fact is, if you ask the average, you know, majority of the population centers are in the big cities, you know, on the East Coast and the West Coast, and there's some population centers within within Western, the mid-states and so on and so forth. But you ask anybody, if you drive outside, you know, away from, if you take people from Las Vegas and drive out of here, and they'll say, oh, this is federal land. It's not federal land. It's public land. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
They put a nomenclature on it. It's federal land. We have to keep saying, well, it's public land. It's not your land. It's my land. You know,
exactly.
It belongs to the people. It doesn't belong to the federal government. All you are is we're actually property owners, and all you are is a management group that's hired to manage this property for us. Not
exactly.
Because you want to come in there. And, you know, you want
Sheriff,
to...
hang on. We got to go to break, and then John in California, I'll take your call when we come back. We'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. Don't go away. This is The Unsolicited Opinion.
Hey, honey, I'm home. I grabbed a newspaper on the way home. Look at all the news today.
Don't you know that all you're going to get in the newspaper is propaganda, twisted news, and false information?
Honey, this is a national newspaper. It has to be true.
Ha! For some reason, the majority of the population believe anything the mainstream media tells them. The newspaper doesn't give out the important attention of what's happening to this country and news that affects our daily lives. Say, does that newspaper mention anything about the North American Union?
No, not that I can see.
I didn't think so. You need to go to www.newswithviews.com, where truth is more important than political correctness. That's www.newswithviews.com. Hey, don't throw that away. We can use that in the birdcage.
Okay, move over. Let me start reading newswithviews.com.
The truth? Read all about it at newswithviews.com. Newswithviews.com, where reality shatters illusion.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman. I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you. That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior. If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free. All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free. I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program for free.
Call now. 1-800-583-1093. 1-800-583-1093. That's 1-800-583-1093.
Are you still paying your credit cards and so-called bank loans thinking that you owe the money? Do you feel like it's your moral obligation, but can't see an end in sight? Well, what if I told you that in truth, you don't owe a single penny, and that the banks know this and hope you don't find out? Here's where we come in. Free2Prosper.com specializes in a profound debt repudiation method, which challenges the validity of your so-called debts, morally frees you from the burdens, and protects your property. Our system is often superior to settlement, bankruptcy, or consolidation, which often leave you in a worse situation. If you feel the moral obligation to take care of yourself and your family, then I urge you to consider taking action right now. The economy will not wait. If you want to know more so you can prosper through the economic collapse, all while staying honorable and true to yourself, then call 877-417-8393. That's 877-417-8393. Or visit free2prosper.com right now.
Hey, everybody, this is Maggie Rodden. This is The Unsolicited Opinion. If you'd like to call into the show, 800-313-9443 is the number to do that. My guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo from Nye County, Nevada. And, Sheriff, we've got a caller on the line, so let's grab this caller real quick before we go on, okay? John in California, you still on with us?
Yeah, I sure am, Maggie. How are you doing this morning?
Well, it was better until I fell backwards off my chair.
I would guess so.
Yeah, yeah, but other than that, I'm surviving reality. So what's cooking, John?
Good morning to you, too, Sheriff Anthony DeMeo. And I first came across Wayne Hage's case a couple of years ago by virtue of another radio talk show host who has recently passed away, Derry Brownfield.
And, okay, yeah.
And so I went on the Internet, Sheriff, and I saw your videos, which were posted up there, and needless to say, I was quite impressed with your actual your statement that you take an oath of office to protect and defend the Constitution, and by golly, there you are, standing up to the BLM and the federal government who were sending their agents in to do their dastardly deeds. And I was just trying to stay on the Constitution. Along those same lines, a lot of us feel that we're being assaulted from all various lots of branches of the government. One of the biggest ones involves the, in my opinion, involves the fraud for the last almost the last 100 years with the Internal Revenue Code, Title 26 of the U.S. Code. And I was just trying to find out from you what you do especially in Nye County, Nevada. You did mention in your dealings with the BLM that they weren't going to do anything unless they could get a court order signed by a judge. Now, as you probably well know, when the IRS comes knocking, they don't have a signed court order. They have what's called it's not even a real lien. It's a notice of a lien. And when you read the notice of a lien, it doesn't say much of anything other than to put the fear of God into who's ever reading it. And they give this to officers in various banks, and you know, the officers in the banks, they forget who their real customers are, the people like me who put their money in deposit accounts or whatever, and they say, oh, yes, sir, you know, we're going to go and give these funds to the IRS. This guy hasn't paid his taxes or some crap like that. So I guess my question is, do you have any special policy relative to this? Do you notify the banks that they in Nye County that they are not allowed to confiscate any of the people in your county who probably voted for you, that they can't confiscate their funds until they have IRS has a valid court order, and you have to, someone's got to review it and see if it's a valid court order? Because I don't think they usually do. The same holds true when they send IRS agents into various people's residence, you know, in the middle of the night. They've got 30 or 40 people out there. That happened to some guy in Oklahoma just recently. And, you know, they put the fear of God in everybody, and they shoot the dogs and all this kind of crap. You know, I mean, this is nothing more than just an assault on the average citizen who, you know, people who have read about the code and who realize all the, you know, we don't have time to go into all right now, but I'm just saying, I was curious if you had done any reading about it. You know, what's your policy on this?
Okay, first of all, when the IRS serves the bank with a notice, they're actually serving the they don't serve the bank in like in Pahrump or Nye County. They serve the bank headquarters.
Right.
So that is where that's taking place, is that the bank the head office or whatever. You know, some of these head offices, like the Bank of America, the head office is not even in Vegas. It's, you know, somewhere in New York or something. I don't know.
True.
Yeah, you know, so what they do is they serve the bank and they say, well, this is what it is. There is a process that Internal Revenue does. The fact of the matter is, a lot of people don't take them seriously enough. I mean, you know, Internal Revenue Service will send out notice of intent. They'll say, this is a notice of intent, this is where you are, and so on and so forth. And they do have a court, they do have a process. The unfortunate thing is people throw those notices.
Hey, everybody, this is Maggie Rodden. The call-in number is 800-313-9443, 800-313-9443. Listen, if you have a business or service that you would like to advertise on a network that truly does redistribute the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, then I suggest that you get in touch with us. You can call RBN at 800-724-2719, 800-724-2719. You can send us a little letter via the U.S. Postal Service, 2251 Double Creek Road, number 302, Round Rock, Texas, 78664 is our address. RepublicBroadcasting.org is our website. You can find us on Facebook, Republic Broadcasting Network. We're on Twitter at RBN Live. You can just send a donation of a few dollars or lots of dollars our way, and so that we can continue to redistribute the truth. And I want to say hello to everybody who's listening all around the country and on, well, the world as well, and our latest station, which is in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, KHFX, 1140 AM, Dallas. So my guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo, and he is the sheriff of Nye County, Nevada. I bet you there's going to be a lot of people moving out to Nye County, Sheriff.
I don't know. I wish they would. Right now, we're the most, you know, we have number one in foreclosures, unfortunately. We're suffering the economic downturn a lot more severely than other parts of the nation. And we were one of the most stressed cities economically. There's like 3,100 counties in the United States. And, you know, we actually, unfortunately, hit a very bad time. I mean, you know, we're struggling along. I mean, that's what we have to do. But we're getting.
Is Vegas in Nye County, Sheriff?
No, Vegas is right outside of Nye County. You know, we're 45 miles from where we are right now to like downtown Las Vegas. It's like 35-minute trip to Vegas. I don't very rarely even get to Vegas. I mostly stay in Nye County. But to finish John's phone call.
Yeah, please.
His question, and that's what you have to do. I mean, the Congress sets all. You know, understand. We got a lot of worst thing we have in Congress is lawyers. Everybody sets these tax
yeah,
laws. I believe we should have average Jane and John Q. Public in these offices, not necessarily all these other professions. And you know, they set these codes, and you know, and a lot of respects. A lot of part about the you know about the IRS code that may not really. That come to muster when they start talking about civil seizure and so on and so forth. And if they're violating, you know, the civil part of the Constitution, which is what Wayne Hage went after for, he went after on the Fifth Amendment and the Fourth Amendment, you know, if you don't, and the due process actually parts that, if you don't have that in check and you don't have your congressional members making sure that everything is done according to the Constitution, believe me, a lot. Sometimes I look at some of these laws that they have, and the Constitution requires that all the laws are applied equally from the federal government across the nation. But when you read certain aspects of the federal law, they'll give special privilege to one state and not necessarily to another state.
And
those are the issues. But IRS is one of those incidents where they have a process to it. I don't think the process is as clear as transparent as it should be. I'll say that. But for IRS to go invading someone's house in the middle of the night with a SWAT team and all of a sudden using armed individuals is a little bit over the top. And unfortunately, some of the federal agencies are using those type of tactics when they go into certain residences using these late at night, SWAT tactics to evade someone's home when basically all you have to do is like knock at a door or go in during the daylight or doing something a little more at night because you don't know. I mean, and a lot of times they do these things outside the knowledge of the local law enforcement agency. Fortunately, we have a good rapport with the federal agencies in Nevada, Nye County Sheriff's Office. We have a good rapport with the FBI. We have a good rapport with DEA and other agencies. And they come to us when they're going to do, an operation. We actually have our people there with them. We do it during normal, we're considered sane times, not necessarily 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the morning. And I have no idea why IRS would actually come to someone's house to do a seizure at 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't know what
I can tell you why. Because they want to instill fear into the people. That's why. They do these things because it's a manipulative tactic to make the citizens fear their government instead of the government fear its citizens.
Well,
that's why they're pulling this crap.
Well, and I understand it, man, because basically they have turned the tables. I mean, we do fear the government more than we actually than the government fears the citizens. Because we hire these people. I mean, we're their employers. I mean, basically.
Yep.
They're employees, and I see that. I see that once they get to Washington, they get a political amnesia. They do things for lobbyists. They do things for anything else. They forget about so much the constituency who they represent, who put them there, and then the only time you actually hear from them basically is when they're running for office or something else, and they're touting all these little different things they do, and a lot of stuff doesn't necessarily benefit the state they represent. benefit somebody else. And, you know, so I think there's a, like, I think there's a big disconnect with, I think a lot of people getting, you know, somewhat pushing people against the wall a lot more now. And I think people feel that pressure. And, you know, and I tell people, you know, the way to handle that is through the election, through the voting booth, to express your, discontent to the, your people through letters and so on and so forth. And, you know, and when they come in into town, to express your discontent. I think when we had that, the medical debate over the health care issue,
right.
A lot of politicians were so, you know, they felt so uncomfortable because they're not used to dealing with the negativity. They're used to people in Washington, D.C. patting them all on the back. Like,
oh,
the friendship
please,
club,
I can't,
you know,
stand
like their big coffee clutch, and they're, you know, they're in their environment. Once you get out of the environment, and all of a sudden you're confronted with the real issues by real people, real concerns, they get very uncomfortable. And that's why.
Well, because we're holding their feet to the fire, and these pricks can't stand it. They can't stand the truth. I'm here in Pennsylvania, and we had Senator Ireland Spector, and then Sebelius came here. They were down at Independence Hall, I think, is where they came to, and what a joke that is, really, because they've never read the Constitution, either one of them. But you know, there were a lot of people that were there asking them questions, but they can't stand it. These people don't want people to confront them and say, wait a second, you said you were going to go do this. I voted for you, and now you're doing exactly the opposite. They need to all be thrown out, every single one of them, from the dog catcher on up. And like Ron Paul had said, we need to get rid of the Bureau of Land Management and the National Forest Service and the EPA and the Department of Environmental Conservation and so on and so forth. They all need to go, all of them, out the door.
And I have to agree that these federal agencies basically empower themselves wrongfully. I mean, and there's no one holding them in check. And if you know, one of the things we have here, you know, when you're in law enforcement, military, and so on and so forth, you give people, you know, the authority to do their job. But you don't give them authority to actually then all come to be super empowered, where now all of a sudden they're running, they're free agents with guns.
Well, yeah,
running,
exactly.
Running all the stuff. It's a term we used in, you know, a term I used here. I said, we don't have, you know, our deputies are not free agents with guns. They're, you know, they have responsibilities. And so you have to hold people in check. You have to hold the federal government in check. You have to hold the agencies in check. But what happens is you have people that basically will say, we have a department over here, and just, you know what, just take care of what we tell you to take care of, and just leave us alone. You don't have all the oversight that you need, and you basically do have too many governments, too many agencies in federal government that we can't even manage our own agencies in the governments. And you start asking, people about the different agencies, they don't have any clue what everyone in those agencies does under their committee and so on and so forth. They have a general idea. They don't know what's going on in the, you know, down on the ground, with the boots on the ground. They have no idea that maybe some of these people are stepping over the line.
And they don't care either.
Well,
when they hear about a Sheriff DeMeo, they don't care. How about, and I've said this before on the show to people listening, they've probably heard me mention this, but I remember reading a couple months ago about some guy with his two little kids, like 3 and 5 years old. A SWAT team came to his house at 6 o'clock in the morning. They were looking for, I don't know if it was his wife or his girlfriend who had lived there, because she didn't pay her student loans.
I heard that. I think.
Remember that?
Yeah. Over the top. I mean, there has to be. There's a term we use here. I mean, I back in Jersey City, I was a SWAT commander. You know, I was in special units, emergency services, like New York City. We dealt with everything. And the term I always mention when we do our tactical operations was we use a measured response. And you know what? The measured response might be having two officers knock at a door, to make arrests, or it may require that we might have to have a SWAT team or something in the middle. I mean, you look at the threat, you look at, and you have a measured response, and you know, and sometimes they don't look at those. It's, you know, you empower somebody. And I got news for you. You know, there's a lot of people that when, you know, when they think about doing one of these things, everyone wants to carry a fully automatic weapon. They want to carry all this stuff. I'm not talking about average law enforcement. I'm talking about sometimes these federal, because they don't deal with people a lot. They look at, here's the time to take out all the toys, and play, and you know, and they overcompensate for the type of threat that you're facing.
Well, Sheriff, What is the Bureau of Land Management or the National Forest Service? What the hell are these people doing walking around with in SWAT team combat outfits?
And see, and that's a question that we should be asking our federal representatives. Like,
yeah.
What do you have? You have people, and all they are, and I'm not trying to demean BLM.
Well, but that is all they are. They're just hired workers. That's all. They're clerks.
That all they are is to make sure that the land is not being abused on our behalf. They represent. They're. You know what? They basically, if you own a piece of property, and property owners will know that, you hire a property agent to make sure your interests are protected. That's it.
Yeah.
And all the agents are people that are basically making sure that the land is not being abused and misused and so on. So within, you know, but that, you know, not to the fact that all of a sudden it's like someone throws a pack of gum on his street. Next thing you know, you have an overwhelming, you know, a whole bunch of people coming down on you. And, you know, so I don't, you know, I'm not in charge of BLM. I'm a local sheriff. I think that, you know, the people I talk to BLM, I get along with them fine. You know, I do have a good relationship with them, but I think that sometimes, depending on outside of the, in certain areas, you have people that just not, they don't believe in measured response. They believe in going over the top. I can't explain to, you know, they're not happening. It's not happening in Nye County. But that would be at the local law enforcement to say, hey, wait a minute, what the heck are you doing?
Well, that's just it. I mean, where I live, I'm outside of Philadelphia in Montgomery County, and there's a farm park not far from where I live where I take my dogs and walk them around. And this town that is right next to mine, that's where they have all their, you know, equipment to plow the roads and that kind of stuff. They had the garage doors open. They've got a tank there, a tank. Now, there's no turret for the guns, but they've got a tank. They call it the rescue unit or something like that, the police rescue unit. Please.
Well, we actually,
I mean, when I was a kid, you had Barney Fife. We don't have Barney Fife anymore.
Well, unfortunately, you know, not average. We actually have it's on a personal carry. I mean, basically it's for people rescuing also. Unfortunately.
Yeah, so they can go and knock people, knock on their door at 6 a.m. because they didn't pay their college tuition bill.
No, and you know, honestly, we don't even deploy. We actually have another vehicle that we deploy, you know, if we're doing a tactical operation. You know, my captain, you know, we both are experienced tactical officers. And they pass, and you know, when they do a tactical operation, they actually pass the tactical plan across my desk. You know, I go, okay, this is okay. Nah, I think I think we don't need that. I think that, you know, we'll use this. We'll use a couple officers instead of, you know, the SWAT team. Because you have people, I want the SWAT team. And, you know, and we'll say, okay, and we'll justify the reason why we want the SWAT team. So they have to present to us the threat. They have to present. And, you know, sometimes we'll send a couple of officers out there. We may send a SWAT member out there, not with all the SWAT gear, but in, you know, with, you know, the uniform, you know, regular deputies, you know. But we're not, you know, you have to look at the threat. And, you know, unfortunately, you know, because of, you know, I was involved in the first World Trade Center terrorist bombing at the World Trade Center. I was involved in an investigation. We were involved in taking down some of the terrorist cells in Jersey City. And my unit, and I was commended by the FBI because we were one of eight people that went and that actually went in and dismantled the second World Trade Center bomb, the one that was found in the space station. You know, so we're realizing that, you know, under some circumstances, these people become a little more violent, and the weapons that they use actually are sometimes more powerful than the weapons that we have as law enforcement. So if we do get involved in a situation where we have to go in and rescue people, we want a little more between us and the bad guy.
I understand that, Sheriff, but when you hear these stories where they're just out gung-ho in force like this, like the example I cited, and you can see numerous examples of where SWAT team is called in and they've got the wrong house and someone ends up being killed because they're at the wrong house.
And you know, sometimes, you know, honestly, I just shake my head. I shook my head when Janet Reno, when the FBI was doing the assault on the compound
in Waco, Texas.
Waco, Texas. I knew the FBI. When you deal with other agencies, you know, and I was dealing with in the tactical operations, you know, stuff like that back in the old, I call it the old country. You know what the limitations are with what the equipment you have. And, you know, for them to, in my opinion, I mean, it was investigated. And in my opinion, when you start pumping gas into a residence, you can't do that because you have a saturation level, which is it actually becomes deadly force because the saturation level of OC or whatever the chemical is using comes to a certain point where people can't even breathe. And then you have children in there and so on and so forth. So, you know, for us to do a tactical operation, there's things that we wouldn't use because we have to look at who's in the house, the ages, and so on. There's a lot of planning that goes into these operations. When they start pumping in the gas with the tanks, I went, they're violating their own policy. They're violating their own procedures. But someone gave them the authority to do that. I'm not blaming the boots on the ground, so to speak. But basically, that was way over the top, especially because you saturate somebody and you can kill them just basically pumping gas into the environment that they have. And, you know, unfortunately, it didn't turn out well for everybody. I mean, it was one of those things where if you talk to the people in Waco, Texas at the time, I'm not trying to second-guess them. I wasn't part of the operation. That was the ATF operation and later the ATF and the other agencies. But they said that Dave Koresh came into town also all the time. They could have picked him up.
Well, yeah, exactly. So what does that tell you? These people are out of control. They're corrupt, and our government is corrupt.
I think a lot of it is poor management. You look at Fast and Furious. I know the sheriffs are down there. I can't speak for Sheriff Back and the other sheriffs on the in Arizona. They're all probably shaking heads. None of my guys would even think about doing anything outside of my passing it through me, especially. I would never allow that, but whoever did allowed it. And, you know, now so you got handguns and weapons of – you got more powerful weapons than local law enforcement has in the hands of drug cartels and so on and so forth. And at the same time, I remember that they were blaming – that the ATF was blaming gun stores in Texas or gun stores in Arizona for selling guns to Mexican drug lords when it turned out – in my opinion, it was the federal government that was doing that, and they were trying to blame the poor average businessman. So
yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. They're the ones behind it. It's just, you know, I don't know, Sheriff. It's just amazing to me. It's amazing to me what's happened in this country.
Well, I think what happens is that we as citizens, I think a lot of people take a very commodious approach to government. Yeah, it's whatever easier, okay. They're not affecting my life. It's someone else. It's always one of those things. Unless your house gets burglarized, they should have done this. When your house gets burglarized, it becomes a real incident. It's like, are we in a recession or depression, or are we okay? If you have a job, you're doing okay. We're doing all right. We're in a recession.
You don't care.
If you lost your job, you're in a depression. I mean, it's the matter. It's how we look at it and from our viewpoint and how it affects us. And a lot of times people allow governments to become. I mean, honestly, back in New York and New Jersey, we don't think that much about the federal government. I mean, you're already, when you're born, you fall into all these rules and regulations. You realize this is it, but you make sure you don't violate the law. But, the fact of the matter is you're kind of used to all this, the zoning and this and that and the other thing. And I never liked it. I mean, a piece of paper, I threw out a piece of paper which was wrapped in garbage was in the garbage. Next thing I know, I get a warning from the recycling guy that should be in the paper recycling.
Yeah, hang on, sure. Sheriff. We got to go to break. We'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Werner will take you when we come back.
Introducing IXL Anti-Friction Metal Conditioner. IXL works at the molecular level to reduce friction by penetrating into and bonding onto the microscopic openings of the walls of ferrous-based metals. The surfaces become smoother and denser, and this reduces the heat, friction, and metal expansion and wear caused by moving metal surfaces. The benefits are reduced maintenance activities and cost, increased fuel efficiency, and prolonged equipment life. It will not clog pipes, injectors, or supply lines, does not build up or accumulate on itself as do many other additives. IXL does not contain
chlorine, moly, PTFE, or graphite. It also offers the tremendous benefit of being non-toxic. It is used for a friction reducer and performance enhancer in gas or diesel engines, transmissions, automatic or standard gearboxes, turbos, electric motors, outdrives, lathe, and cutting applications. Go to republicbroadcasting.org, then to our online store, or call us at 800-724-2719. That's 800-724-2719.
Are you still paying your credit cards and so-called bank loans thinking that you owe the money? Do you feel like it's your moral obligation but can't see an end in sight? Well, what if I told you that in truth, you don't owe a single penny and that the banks know this and hope you don't find out? Here's where we come in. Free2Prosper.com specializes in a profound debt repudiation method which challenges the validity of your so-called debts, morally frees you from the burdens, and protects your property. Our system is often superior to settlement, bankruptcy, or consolidation, which often leave you in a worse situation. If you feel the moral obligation to take care of yourself and your family, then I urge you to consider taking action right now. The economy will not wait. If you want to know more so you can prosper through the economic collapse, all while staying honorable and true to yourself, then call 877-417-8393. That's 877-417-8393. Or visit free2prosper.com right now.
Do you flinch when a police car appears in your rearview mirror or you get pulled over? Are you squeamish when an envelope arrives in the mail with a return address of a court, a government agency like the IRS, or some law firm? Would you like to escape government agency harassment? Then visit escapeharassment.com. George Bush allegedly says, the government constitution is nothing but a doggone piece of paper. Well, that's a contract. A contract is an offer acceptance of that offer, at which point a contract arises by law and the offeror can no longer withdraw the offer. We teach, do not accept. That way there is no contract or agreement for you to go to their court or private club meeting. To escape government agency harassment like the IRS, visit escapeharassment.com. This is a tried and proven experienced process, not experimental, with a money-back guarantee that it works and success testimonials from previous students. Remember, escapeharassment.com. That's escapeharassment.com.
Hey everybody, this is Maggie Rodman, and this is the Unsolicited Opinion, and the call-in number is 800-313-9443. 800-313-9443 is the number. My guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo from Nye County in Nevada. And somebody sent me an email. Maybe you can answer their question, Sheriff, and then I'm going to grab a caller. It was somebody who has dredging rights in California, and they ask, how do I get my dredging rights back and the right to make a living with my dredging when fish and game comes along and just stops us? How do I put my dredge back in the water without being shot? That's their question.
I don't know. Everyone's situation is different. Yeah, there's a lot of things in, you know, Wayne Hage, I was very familiar with that case, and it was like that was pretty, you know, pretty transparent. A lot of these cases has to do with different kind of rights and responsibilities and what you're allowed. I mean, and, you know, I always tell people, you know, talk to a federal claims lawyer. I mean, because that's what Wayne Hage filed in federal claims court, which is a lot different than in federal district court. And the claims court actually is sometimes the best venue for people to file some of these takings claims, which is what this, if they remove this guy's, this person's rights to use a right they have or a property right they have, sometimes claims court's the best prevent response. I can't answer those questions because I don't know all the nuances, you know, all the particulars of the case, you know, or the situation. Is it something that he was given these rights, you know, that these property rights based upon some type of a pre-existing agreement? And, of course, you're talking about California. And is it the state fishing game, or is it the federal fishing game? I don't have enough information to make any type of response. But I tell people, you know, they, you know, when they call us, talk to a lawyer or talk to somebody that is very familiar. And there's a lot of organizations out there that actually have lawyers and actually have legal representation where they can actually guide you. You don't necessarily have to talk to a lawyer. You just got to get a hold of, you know, a group that has that deal with property rights. And one was the cattle organization here in Nevada, which was the daughters of Wayne Hage was on that board. And I know that his other daughters are in Idaho or something like that. I mean, and they have these organizations that pretty much help people through their property issues. They guide them.
Yeah.
They guide them. And this is what this person should do.
Yeah. All right.
I know that people look at these situations, and a lot of people are afraid. And unfortunately, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that some of these people are on the extreme, but there's some people that are afraid because what they see in the newspaper, what they've read about, what has happened in the past with agencies, that they're afraid for their lives. And I would say that sometimes it's a baseless fear. But as you look at sometimes, it could be a fear that is based in some type of reality when you look at the when you look at some of these circumstances where you find people losing their lives. Exactly.
I mean, it's totally out of control. And, you know, the fear is very understandable. I mean, it's very understandable that the American people are now frightened because of the things that are being allowed to occur, Sheriff DeMeo. And you know, there's not enough people like yourself and Sheriff Arpaio and Sheriff Mack. Unfortunately, there aren't enough of you. There aren't enough of you who recognize that your oath is to the Constitution, you work for the people, and not these crooks that have been put in positions of power or they think this is their little fiefdom.
Well, I agree, Maggie, but you can't make this office. There's a lot of things I did when I first took office and I had change. And it wasn't that popular with the people, but these would make the office more effective and so on and so forth. And people were upset about that. I said, well, I'm here to manage the sheriff's office. We have to lower crime. I don't have enough manpower. There's certain programs I have to put in place. We still respond to every call for service we get. We respond to call for service. Now, agencies strapped as we are don't do that. They forward people to different, come up to the station or whatever. We don't do that. You have a problem, we'll send a deputy out. You might have to wait, but we'll send a deputy out because your call for service is important to us. The fact of the matter is that a lot of agencies and a lot of people, you know, kind of forget that, you know, we're here to serve the people. And unfortunately, where a lot of the issues are taking place, are not necessarily those in the state, but a lot of issues that are taking place which control everyone's lives, which has a broad effect and a broad everlasting effect, is at the federal level. Where they make these laws and they push these laws out there. Who can read them? The tax code is like 2 million letters or 2 million words. I don't know. Who's going to read all that, you know?
Yeah,
and
I know.
They talk in some type of Klingon language. I don't know. I mean,
it's
really,
the truth. They talk in riddles. And, you know, instead of being plain language that everyone can easily understand, it's the truth.
But they don't talk in plain language. They talk in plain language, people will be shocked. And unfortunately, we have people, you know, we're in a presidential race at this time, even though it really starts in a couple of months. But, you know, I want people to start, you know, putting things out in plain language. I mean,
Sheriff, hang on. We got to go to another break. We'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. And then Werner in New Brunswick, I'll grab you when we come back. Don't go away. This is the Unsolicited Opinion. My name is Maggie Rodden. We'll return.
You're listening to the Republic Broadcasting Network because you can handle the truth.
Warning for all Gulf Coast disaster survivors. Be aware that dangerous gases are in the air you breathe. Benzene, hydrogen sulfide, methylene chloride, and Corexit 9500. Keep your body clean with microplant powder. For all Gulf Coast residents and all who want to be healthy, hempusa.org brings you a new formulation of microplant powder with lactobacillus acidophilus, rebuilding your immune system while detoxing the rest of your body, pulling out positive toxins, heavy metals, viruses, fungus, bacteria, and parasites. Cleans and purifies the blood, lungs, stomach, and colon. Microplant powder will help eliminate these dangerous chemicals from the body used in the Gulf cleanup. At hempusa.org, we want you to try our number one selling detox product, microplant powder. Call and order at 1-908-691-2608. 1-908-691-2608. Or visit us at hempusa.org today.
Extend your life with
Are you or someone you know suffering from high blood pressure, cholesterol, or chest pains? Are you looking for a more natural way to overcome these health challenges? Extendivite is made from herbs known to help with these symptoms. Made from garlic, cayenne, hawthorn, and four other herbs, Extendivite goes to work detoxifying heavy metals and killing fungus and virus to enhance your overall health. For only $69.95 plus shipping and handling for a two-month supply of either capsules or liquid, you too can begin on your path to better health. For more information, call 1-877-928-8822. That's 1-877-928-8822 or visit our website at heartdrop.com.
Extend your life with Extendovite.
Corporate media dominates the American opinion. Finding independent voices that counter this avalanche is becoming increasingly difficult. With the endless corruption running rampant throughout our government, independent voices are needed more than ever to battle the offensive against our freedoms and liberties. As a listener of RBN, no one understands this concept better than you. Now it's up to you to do your part. The time has come for you to take action and begin broadcasting the truth to hundreds or thousands of people every month. Sound impossible? Quite the contrary. With pointed slogans from LibertyStickers.com, you can reach countless sleeping Americans unaware that they live in a real-life wonderland. LibertyStickers.com has a huge inventory of political bumper stickers and messages that reflect the truth about our government, our politicians, and the future of America. With so many in stock, there's one perfect for you. Visit us today at LibertyStickers.com. Again, that's LibertyStickers.com. Do your part. Your voice is important. Let it be heard.
Hey everybody, this is Maggie Rod, and this is the Unsolicited Opinion. The call-in number is 800-313-9443, 800-313-9443. Sheriff, do you want to finish making your point? Then I'm going to bring on a caller.
Oh, okay, I appreciate it, Maggie. I think English only should start in Washington, D.C. My opinion.
Oh, ain't that the truth? You got that one right. Let's take Werner in New Brunswick. Hi, Werner. How are you?
Oh, I just listened with interest there with what Sheriff DeMeo had to say about Wayne Hague. But this is a pattern that's basically worldwide. The people in the rural areas have been, and that are making a living in the rural areas, have been run roughshod over by bureaucrats.
Yeah.
And by whatever the global agenda is, because we are thorn in their side. They don't want people self-sufficient. They want to incorporate everybody into their global system. And in regard to those squad teams and this basically this oversupply or this menace of cancer like bureaucracy, the one in behind the scenes, they rather have them on their payroll than having them unemployed on the street.
Sheriff, you have a comment?
Well, I kind of agree that, you know, in a lot of respects, you know, it's easier if you want to, if you have a certain agenda, it's a lot easier to confine people to a certain area and restrict them from having, you know, the ability to have a free range. I mean, you know, this country, America was founded on pioneer. I mean, I think we kind of lost the pioneer spirit, that fighting spirit, that, you know, regardless about all the obstacles, hindrances for us, we want to attain a goal. And, you know, people still want that, and it flies in the face of, you know, what people, what some of the agendas are. And there are agendas out there. I mean, the agendas with the public lands are agendas that you know, all these extreme organizations like Sierra Club and so on and so forth want to control that. They don't want you to utilize your resources. They don't, you know, we have oil in Nye County. And a lot of people don't realize, we have gold. We're one of the largest probably gold in the world, and we have to have oil here. And, you know, we can't. You know, we're restricted, unfortunately, because of the Bureau of Land Management from utilizing all the resources we have in our county to the betterment of not only the citizens of our county, but also for our national defense and for the welfare of our citizens outside of our county.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, he's right. I mean, it's easier when you start confining people to a certain type of, geographical location. And, you know, if you read Storm of Rangelands, you read why there's so many restrictions on land in the West It's because the fact of the matter is that the people in power at the time realized that there's a lot of wealth and a lot of opportunity in the West. It was going to be in complete competition with what was going on in New York and the East Coast and in that area. They didn't want that competition. They didn't want also that wealth transferring from the East Coast to either the middle of America or to the West Coast. And, you know, there was a power grab. That's all of a sudden why they started, passing all these laws and why you had to restrict railroads for a certain area, and why the Yellowstone Park areas were all of a sudden brought on to, protection under the federal government per se. But, you have to really read the book to understand some of the history of this country and why certain things are the way certain why it is. Now, out here in Nevada, in the West, we have a lot of land, Nye County, you could fit Massachusetts, Delaware, New Jersey, and, Massachusetts, Delaware, state of Rhode Island, and New Jersey, and still have room left over just in Nye County.
Yeah, yeah. See, but, yeah, the enormity of the size of the county is just...
Right, but water out here is the precious resource. That's why, Las Vegas is everybody's looking to stick straws in rural parts of Nevada to bring water down to the, to the population areas. So they kind of control that, and they kind of, then they tell you can't use the land for its intended purpose. You can't use the land for this. You can't lose the land for that. And they restrict, like he was like the caller saying, they start restricting you what you're allowed to do. They restrict your personal liberties. They restrict you your ability to actually enjoy the freedoms that this country was founded on. And also once you're confined to rules and regulations, then you don't have that much room to grow, and then you have to capitulate and be compliant with what they want for your life. I don't think it's right. I mean, I moved to Perrin Valley, which didn't have any zoning. Now all of a sudden, everybody that comes from these areas like California and other areas, they can't live without zoning. They're starting zoning us to death out here. You fight it, but the politicians, they these people that are put in office, they agreed to it, and I don't believe in zone. I came out here open use. I was very happy having my property open use. I didn't care what was put next to me, and that's what happens. They can't live without the. You have people that live in cities that want to live outside the cities and enjoy all the freedoms that the rules offer. They get to rural areas. They can't live without. They find out they can't live without somebody telling them what to do.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, it's like the farmers who are out in the country, and then you get some city slicker, as they say, to come out, and they don't like the smell of cow manure, and it's just, sometimes, honestly, I just like to slap these people, them silly, they're so stupid.
Well, they call saying is right. I mean, they're restricting you from doing all that. They don't want you to enjoy all the freedoms. In fact, they just rather have you live in the city, in an urban jungle, and leave the rest to whoever to lack of use. I mean, we have oil, we have gas, we have so many natural resources that can make us energy independent, and we have people that refuse to use it.
I think it's from the Nature Conservancy. I don't know. I can't remember his name. I didn't look it up. But he's got, there's an area of land, and he's got a little retreat right in the middle of this land that, of course, they drove the people off the land. And I'm not sure if it's out in Wyoming or Montana. I'm not sure. I wish I could think of his name. But he's got a little retreat. It may be in Washington State. He's got a little retreat of, thousands of acres for himself and his buddies, but everybody else was driven off the land. These people are absolutely hypocrites.
Well, it's the same situation, right around the world, where they drive the native people off the land, like in Central America, South America, in Africa,
Yeah.
And now we, the rural people, we are the native people.
Yeah, you're right there, Werner.
And with this government, with the financial situation, how much longer can they afford waste so much money for this bureaucracy and the enforcement and everything? I consider that nothing else but a form of glorified welfare.
Well, I have to agree that we're not allowed to use our country to its full resource. I've been reading somewhere that if they were able to use the Midwest of America for farming, And with the resources that are there, it actually would feed over a billion people. We could feed a billion people, just in a section of America. We have oil reserves. We have gas reserves. We have a lot of wealth and richness in this country, but what we want to do is import it from someplace else and not give them the opportunity for this country to actually be energy independent. Green energy, all the solar stuff, and I believe in technology, but everything I've read for years says that the advancements that we need are about a couple decades away before we're going to have anything that's actually sufficient enough for us to invest in these green energies, which basically what the economists are saying when they search it, for every green job we create, we actually lose 2.6 jobs on the other side.
Yep, and Spain's a perfect example of that because they moved to a so-called green economy years ago, and their unemployment rate is 20%, and it'll stay at that. This is all, it's just about power and control. It's not about utilizing resources. It has nothing to do with the environment because global warming is one big lie and hoax that these pricks have perpetrated on people, many of whom buy into it because they're too stupid to realize that when they breathe out, they exhale carbon dioxide, and plants love it. They eat it, and they grow and become more prolific because of it. But because we have this educational system that has turned our country into a nation of dolts, nobody understands these basic concepts. It just makes me hostile. It really does.
Well, it's not the same country I was born into.
Me either.
And unfortunately, we lost a lot of our, chutzpah. We lost a lot of, we lost our position in the world. And I want to, pointing out some of the issues that, that we're fighting. I mean, as Americans, that we're in this dilemma, which way we're going to go. We have no clear direction from the people that that represent us in Washington, really.
They don't represent us. They represent bankers. They represent the schmucks who own the Federal Reserve Bank. That's who they represent. Rockefeller, Rothschild, Warburg, J.P. Morgan, Schiff, Mellon. Those pricks are who they represent. They don't represent us. But there are more of us than there are of them, and that's what they keep forgetting, Sheriff. There's millions of American people who aren't getting aren't represented that are starting to figure out what the real story is.
Well, they don't think they represent us if American citizens don't tell them and remind them who they represent. Here's a perfect example. In Nye County, we have Yucca Mountain. That's the federal repository. Now, we want the citizens in every rural area surrounding Nye County want Yucca Mountain to go through. I mean, basically, for us, we felt that we were getting billions of dollars and funds because it's not property in Nye County for the federal government, and we felt that Yucca Mountain's fine with us. All the representatives we have representing us say, "Well, no, we don't want it for Nevada." But no, when we bring it out that we want it, we've had federal people from the federal government, a couple of congressmen that sit on the Department of Energy board. We had meetings, and we had all these rural areas saying, "We know," and they keep saying, "Well, Clark County." Let me tell you, this would never come within 100 miles of Clark County. All the rural areas where this was going to come through in Nevada said we want the project in Nevada. We felt that it would bring an economic boon to the state, and it's going to be an amount that basically, that you can bury it for 10,000 years. No one's going to really care. It's not going to go anywhere. And they said no. And so they don't even represent the people. When we bring this to our attention, they say no because they're into what's going to get them. And I understand why they may be saying, because the majority of people in Las Vegas, where the population is, says, well, we don't want it there. It's gonna depreciate property values. You look at New York City.
Look, Vegas is already. How much lower can the property values get? When don't you have the highest foreclosure rate in Vegas? Hello, kids.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's we fight with them all. We just basically sometimes, we just say, hey, please, y'all better talk it to us. It doesn't really occur. I think it's political amnesia, honestly. They're looking, I'm not saying all of them, but they're looking for the next race, to win the next race. And, honestly, I've been very successful. I mean, I'm in my third term. I didn't do things for, my staff could tell you, I didn't do things that were politically, directed. I did things, that were directed in order to better serve the people in that county, which a lot of times it makes people mad because, you know, you do things that, I want this, how come you're not doing this, how come you're not doing this? I have to sit back and say, I know this is what you want as a whole, but that's not the way in law enforcement. That's the way I have to, you know, I'm going to be able to have a very functional sheriff's office. You know, I'll stand for the Constitution. I'll do the job that you guys are hiring me to do. You put me in this job to manage this office, and I'm going to do the best job I can. And that's why we're here.
Yeah, exactly. That's what you're there for. Yeah.
Unfortunately, you have to run for a political office. But you know, if you recognize they have to run for political office, but if you're a true public servant, you know, I think that you can serve better. You know.
Well, yeah, the truth really does. I mean, I think, honestly, Sheriff, I think so many more people, if they just stood on principle and ran on principle, it is such a breath of fresh air when you hear somebody like yourself or Sheriff Arpaio speak, people who are, you know, well-known. It's such a breath of fresh air to the American people when they hear somebody who's actually standing on principle, right versus wrong, period.
And, you know, because like the Governor Christie in New Jersey, because they were touting him as the president. And the reason why they're touting him, because he speaks truthfully. I mean, he just speaks. Right. I have issues with Christie because, he's done some things, on the public side, the public sector. Even though I don't live there, I have friends that are still cops there. And, you know, but the fact of the matter is, he says it like it is. From what we understand, from what I see 2,500 miles away, he basically is plain spoken. I think the fact of the matter is I think if somebody comes into this presidential race that's plain spoken, doesn't talk politics, and just basically said this way it is, we have an agenda we have to do, there's things we have to look at as a country. I don't know how we're going to get there because some of these archaic laws that we have are confusing American people, and no one knows exactly where they stand, but I'm going to bring clarity and transparency and try to get all this minutiae out of the government that's there now. I think the person would have a better chance than what I see. But I'm seeing politicians, and unfortunately, I just see politicians that are there, people that actually have some good ideas are not getting the recognition, that they should have. And,
well,
you know, and unfortunately, that these things are controlled by groups and organizations that are outside of our ability to touch, you know.
Yeah, well, because those organizations own the media. They own the mainstream media. That's why the message isn't out there. The only one who talks about ending the Federal Reserve Bank, which is a privately held corporation owned by gangsters, is Ron Paul. But they don't give him the time of day. They marginalize him. They think, you know, he's just some crazy old man, which of course he's speaking the truth. That's why they don't even count him in these so-called polls and all this other crap. It's all a game. It's all a hustle because these pricks own the game, but they don't own the American people. That's the difference that the American people need to recognize.
Well, I met Ron Paul when he ran for president the last time. You know, he asked me because of course I gave him what I felt was going on in the country. And you know, I said basically is that, you know, and one of the concerns I have is that we actually, there's oil OPEC. We know that. And they control the price of oil throughout the world. And my concern to him was the fact of the matter is we have lost our farming ability. We have lost the ability for us to properly, use our nation, our land for farming. And we're actually exporting a lot of stuff within this country. And I said, you know, the problem is if these countries that grow food for us and sell food for us get involved in like a food OPEC, you know, we're going to be restricted. You know, we're going to find it very hard then for us to now get back our farmlands. It's like manufacturing. We gave away all our industry to other countries. Try to restart industry in this country. You know, I remember reading a story where they were building like so many during World War II. I think it's B-17s. I'm not sure, or that they were building like maybe 100 planes a day, or some kind of outrageous number that they were doing in a plant that was back during World War II. And and I looked at that. That was the industrial might of America. We have lost that.
Deliberately, it's been deliberately done. Listen, Sheriff, we got to go to the last and final break. We'll be back in 3 minutes, everybody. This is the Unsolicited Opinion. We'll return. Don't go away.
purification systems have long been recognized as the world's ultimate in water purification. Berkey's are used worldwide under normal, hostile, and emergency environments. Securing your access to good-tasting, sparkling, wholesome drinking water can be harder than you might expect. Water is often laced with chlorine, lead, high levels of harmful bacteria, and other unwanted chemicals and contaminants. Even bottled water can contain these contaminants, and moreover, it's expensive. Other purification systems are inferior. Most do remove pathogenic bacteria, and many remove the beneficial minerals that your body needs. Perhaps that's why Berkey systems have long been recognized as the world's ultimate in water purification. This simple, highly effective method of microporous, self-sterilizing, and recleanable black Berkey purification elements bring you the finest water purification system available anywhere. Call today, 1-800-724-2719. That's 1-800-724-2719. Or go to our online store, republicbroadcasting.org. Free shipping for a limited time only.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman. I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you. That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior. If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free. All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free. I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program for free.
Call now, 1-800-583-1093. 1-800-583-1093. That's 1-800-583-1093.
Are you still paying your credit cards and so-called bank loans thinking that you owe the money? Do you feel like it's your moral obligation, but can't see an end in sight? Well, what if I told you that in truth, you don't owe a single penny, and that the banks know this and hope you don't find out? Here's where we come in. Free2Prosper.com specializes in a profound debt repudiation method, which challenges the validity of your so-called debts, morally frees you from the burdens, and protects your property. Our system is often superior to settlement, bankruptcy, or consolidation, which often leave you in a worse situation. If you feel the moral obligation to take care of yourself and your family, then I urge you to consider taking action right now. The economy will not wait. If you want to know more so you can prosper through the economic collapse, all while staying honorable and true to yourself, then call 877-417-8393. That's 877-417-8393. Or visit free2prosper.com right now.
Everybody, this is The Unsolicited Opinion, and my website is three words, theunsolicitedopinion.com. If you'd like to go there, lots of information up there. My guest this morning is Sheriff Tony DeMeo, and he is the sheriff from Nye County, Nevada, and he is one of the sheriffs who believes in standing up and supporting the Constitution, and he works for the people. What a novel thought, Sheriff, I'm telling you. Are you there?
There's a lot of law enforcement that are doing that. So.
Well, I would wish more of them would make their presence known. Sheriff, I know there are more people. I realize that. It sounds like I'm painting everybody with a broad brush, and I don't mean to be doing that. But, Sheriff, you've stood up. Sheriff Apayo stands up. Sheriff Mack has stood up, and I know there's several others because I've read about them going up against like Bureau of Land Management, I think it was, a sheriff down in, I'm not sure, somewhere in Nevada, Arizona, who they had were being prevented from harvesting some of the timber, and they stood up and said, no, you're not doing that to us, and we're going to use our lands as we see fit, kind of a thing. And I know there are others, but there's just not enough of you. That's the problem.
Like I said, I know that there's many, I know a lot of my brethren believe in the same things, and they do a great job for the citizens. And this came out, honestly, because of what was going on Wayne Hage, and, of course, the victory Wayne Hage, his family. Unfortunately, he didn't get a chance to see it. And, you know, they want to know what was behind the story. And I said, well, this is what I did. I mean, you told people that do this, and I'm going to say, I did my job. I mean, that's what I'm here for. I didn't think anything of it. I just went, They're not going to push my citizens around. They're in the wrong. And, you know, someone's got to stand up and say, this ain't going to happen. And I'm not going to have it on my watch. And I just did the job that, you know, I swore to do. And I told Wayne Hage, this is all I'm doing is just doing my job. And, this is what we have to expect. I mean, everybody, you know, it's kind of interesting that when someone does their job, you're kind of saying, wow, thanks for doing your job. Just job. I mean, it seems to be that rare.
It is.
For someone
you had mentioned what happened in Waco, Texas. Now, what if those FBI agents had said, or the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms had said, wait a second, this doesn't make sense. I'm not going to follow these orders because they're not lawful orders. How about that, Sheriff? That's what we need to see take place, that if you're given orders that are unconstitutional and against your oath of office, that you say, wait a second, I'm not going to do that. Like, look at, we know that they had disarmed law-abiding citizens before Hurricane Katrina.
Well, let me give you what happened in Jersey City. I was a tactical officer in Jersey.
And, Sheriff, I got to let you know, we've only got about another minute.
I'll compress it. I was told by a supervisor, there was a tactical operation. I told my supervisor, this is what I want you to do. I told him I'm not doing it. In fact, I told my guys that we're backing up, we're leaving. Eventually, he came back to me and says, we were already leaving. I said, you're going to do that, and you're going to get these guys to do the job your way. I'm not putting my people in danger, the citizens of their house in danger, by doing something which is tactically wrong. And he capitulated, and we did, and we had a very successful operation, and no one was hurt. Everybody, we got the bad guys, we got the citizens out, we got the people that were in danger out of there. No horse got hurt, suspect didn't get hurt, and citizens didn't get hurt.
Yeah.
That's what you have to do. Sometimes you have to say, this is wrong. I mean, I did that. I could get suspended. I went, ain't going to happen.
Yeah. Sheriff, I want to thank you so much for coming on with me today. I appreciate your time. Sheriff Tony DeMeo, Nye County, Nevada. Everyone applaud this gentleman who stands on principle. Thank you, Sheriff. I appreciate your time.
My pleasure. Thanks again, Maggie.
You're welcome. Hey, everybody, I love to go to Oz. Somewhere Over the Rainbow is a wonderful place to be. Chin up, everybody, because we have people like Sheriff Tony DeMeo who are standing up for you and I, so that's a wonderful thing. Listen, sun will come up tomorrow. It always does, so don't lose heart. And another great show follows mine, so stay tuned for Deanna Spingola. Chin up, everybody. I'll be back tomorrow. Yeah.